And we are live. Good afternoon. Welcome to our ninth Waymo Tuesday's webinar. Starting the holidays, the last one. We're still thinking about maybe continuing this set of webinars after the holidays. But let's focus on today first. Today we have Dirk van der Woude talking about RDP brute force attacks. But before I give the presentation to Dirk, I have some slides to share with you. First of all, we cannot host these kinds of events without our sponsors. So a big thanks to our sponsors. Actually, InSpark, where Dirk works, is one of our sponsors, and we are happy with these kinds of sponsors because they provide us with rooms, food, etc., and making things possible. We have all kinds of social media channels. I think the most important one is our Twitter handle. So if you want to ask us questions outside of the Q&A, you can use the hashtag WMERC_NL. We will be closely monitoring that hashtag, and if any question pops up, we'll make sure to ask that question to Dirk in the webinar. We even have a Jammer channel, but we don't use it anymore. The meeting is recorded as well, and we are posting that on our YouTube channel. Please subscribe to the channel so that we are able to transform this ugly URL into a more meaningful URL. But it requires a certain amount of subscribers in order to do so. For now, I want to give the presentation to Dirk. Dirk, good luck. And the floor is yours.
Now, let me share my screen.
Yeah, you're off.
Yes, I think you can see my screen now. Great, let's start. Now, thanks for having me. My presentation is about Azure Sentinel and then a real-world use case, the brute force attacks on the remote access protocols. It started with RDP, but I included SSAs for the Linux fans in this meeting. Small introduction about myself, Dirk van der Woude. I'm a principal consultant within InSpark, basically lead of the cybersecurity team and technical architect of our cloud security center. It's a cloud native SOC, which we won the Global Security and Compliance Award last year. So very proud of that. RDP attacks. When I did my investigation, I thought that phishing email was the number one attacks, but what it happens that the RDP compromise is still the number one attack in our cybersecurity world. What you see and what we also see within our SOC is that people starting in the reconnaissance phase to slowly see what ports are open. If they are open, they try to attack on that port. For example, in the RDP attack, guest username password. If people enter the environment, they do reconnaissance and see where the backup is located, which AV solutions are used. And if everything's in place, they destroy the backup, shut down the antivirus and encrypt all data. We see it happen a lot. So it's very important to protect RDP, but also detect if it's being compromised. Now, for this, I set up a honeypot network. The slides will be shared, so you can do it on your own. And the honeypot network is basically what I did is, I'll show you here. I implemented a Windows server in Azure with port 3389 open. I also did it with a Linux server with port 2222 open. But this server we will use to make some attacks on external attacks on the RDP port. You will see I'm not alone who will do the RDP attacks. Some people will join me. So when we have the Azure virtual machine with the public IP port 3389 open, we can verify if the port is open. What we can do is we can use Kali Linux. So let me log on to my Linux server and do an nmap. When the machine is located in Azure, you do not get a response if you don't use the parameter minus capital P N. It's a no ping. So we can see our public IP port 3389 is open from the internet. Now this is a manual scan on one IP address. And what you see is there are also internet port scanners. And for example, if we use Shodan and we look at remote access protocol, we'll see that a lot of ports are opened. This is not that much. Let me see if RDP gives more results. No. But this is an internet port scanner that will scan if a port is open on the internet. It will show you the logon screen. And yeah, it's very vulnerable. If you look at SSH, for example, it's much, much, much more connected devices to the internet. Mostly it has to do with the Internet of Things, Raspberry Pis, etc. But SSH, very vulnerable, 22 million devices connected to the internet. So we did verify that the port is open. Hackers will use an internet port scanner. And from there, we can use an RDP session to log on to the system and guess the password. What we also can do is, for example, use Hydra. And Hydra is a brute force attack. So I'm using a password text, rockyou.txt. And we have to wait for a few seconds before it starts. So here you can see it's using the username administrator and try to guess a lot of passwords on the RDP session. Let's close it for now, else my system will be slow. So here you can see opening RDP to the internet is very dangerous. And in this session, I will show you that we can use Azure Sentinel to do some kind of detections. And I walk you through the basic components of Sentinel with the data set we have from the RDP attack. Now, Azure Sentinel, probably you've seen a lot of presentations, is cloud-native SIEM solution from Microsoft. Basically, it connects a lot of data sources and do analytics rules to see alerts, incidents, some kind of dashboard viewing. Now, what do we need to do when we start Azure Sentinel? We need to store the data in a log analytics workspace. A single workspace is always recommended, but cross workspace is supported, also Azure Lighthouse. And if you see this screen, and this, for example, I have a few workspaces. If I select multiple workspaces, I can use the multiple workspace view, and then I see an overview of all workspaces, the incident page, not the other pages, but only the incident page. Now, for this test, I will first open this one. And if we have selected the log analytics workspace, you want to connect your log sources to it. It can be Microsoft, it can be non-Microsoft, it can be the Microsoft 365 E5 products, a backend infrastructure. Now, for this is the RDP protocol attack is a security event in the event viewer, and that's on the local service. So to connect the service to your Azure Sentinel, we need the security events, and it will read the security event log data. For Linux servers, it's the syslog for SSH, and you need to enable the auth and auth prev to get logon data for SSH attacks. So let me show you on the screen again. We go to data connectors. we scroll down to security events, open the connector page, and here I can see what I want to connect. Now I've set the log collection to minimal, and that has to do with cost. And the thing we see often with Azure Sentinel, it's a nice product, but the cost is sometimes very hard to calculate. Now, what we have done in our environment, we have a lot of servers connected to Azure Sentinel for a lot of different customers. And on average, it's $5 per server per month if you use the minimal event log. If you use common, it's €8.25. But for this use case, minimal is enough. And what's nice, if you connect all Microsoft M365 E5 security products like Azure ATP, Azure AD Identity Protection, Cloud App Security, MDATP, then you will see that even for a company with 10,000 plus users, it will only cost you around $5 of euros a month. And that's because only the alerts and incidents are sent to Sentinel. And with the Windows Server, you send all events, all security events, and that's more data. So that's why the price is per server as much as a whole infrastructure with 10,000 people on the Microsoft 365 E5 security products. Now we have the data connected. How do we start? I always start with the logs because I think I know what I want, but let's check. So I go to the logs. I see my data connector is enabled and I go to security events where event ID equals 4625 is somebody trying to log to the system but unsuccessfully. So if I run the query, I see I get results. And if I open the results, I can see which data I can use because we want to use at a later stage entities because only an alert doesn't give me the data I want. I want to see which account name is used and which IP it's coming from. And you can see which what are the names for the attributes we can use at a later stage. So we use the logs. The security event is the table. The event ID is the column which we will search for. And we can now create an incident rule in the analytics part. And an incident rule is a name. You can use the description, the MITRE tactics. Is it reconnaissance? In which stage of an attack is this happening? The severity, high, medium, low, or informational. The query itself plus the entities, I will show you later. It's a scheduled run. The Microsoft 365 E5 products are push runs because that are already pushed by the system itself. The queries we are creating, the scheduled ones, the custom ones, we can schedule every 5 minutes, every hour, every 24 hours. And there's a grouping option that will match the entity to get multiple entities in one alert, so to say. And you can use automation playbooks to respond to an alert. Now, the alert we will use is the security event where event ID is 4625. And we want to use the entity account and IP address. Because we will use it at a later stage for investigation, automation, and a grouping. And the grouping example I show you here, if I don't do the grouping, every RDP attack gets an alert and it's really overflowing the system. If I group on an entity, then all the same alerts will be combined into one incident, as you can see at the bottom. Now, let's create an incident rule. So we go to analytics. We click create. Now I need my glasses. Scheduled query. So this will be the RDP brute force attack. Now the description can be the same. You can use the description at a later stage if you do the the mitigation and you want to create a ticket, for example. Now this is somebody that's trying to use credential access and for example, initial access to the system. Now this is medium alert. Now the query itself, let me copy it from, don't have to type it. So this is the query in the log we used. And I would like to use as an account principal name. Add that as an entity. And I want to use the IP address. On the right side, you can see there's data already in the system available. Here's my IP address. Now run this query, for example, this is just for demo, but I want to run it every 5 minutes. The threshold has to be more than zero. So each incident here, I can do the grouping optional. And here I can do an automated response, more on that later. But for example, let's select this one, review and create the query. This is how easy it is. If you go to the analytics space, this is a custom query. There are also a lot of queries available from Microsoft that you can see in this list. Not all queries are available for all data. It has to match the data connector, so to say. So you have to see what's happening, which data connectors are you using, which query you can use within your own system. Plus, maybe you can add some custom queries. When you're done with the queries, you let it run. And in the overview section, you can see which alerts are being created, alerts and incidents. Now, how does that look? This is the incident page. And in the overview page, you also see the last 24 hours of incidents. Now, I already got an alert. So this is the alert page, and you can see a lot of events happening, one alert, and this is the data set. And from the alert page, if you go to the incident itself, if you use the grouping, you see more alerts combined into one incident. You can go to the graphical investigation part of the alert. Now, how does that look? Here on the left side, I can click investigate and I see my entities. So the IP addresses that I use for the brute force attack, attacking my system. Here is the timeline. If there's more alerts in the timeline, it will be a correlated alert, an incident, so to say. And here you can see the IP addresses that are used for this attack. Now, what's another option? I will switch to my other systems because in our SOC we have a honeypot network, and it's nice to see what happens if you got multiple systems connected worldwide to the same data connector, to the same SIEM system. So I can do hunting, and let me show you where the incident rules are reactive rules. Hunting is proactive. So I can go to the hunting page and, for example, use this one, run the query, view the results. And in this query, you can see where a single IP address is attacking more than one server in our honeypot network. And it was nice to see when we set up this honeypot infrastructure for a SOC to get some kind of intelligence, we saw within a few hours single IP addresses attacking all servers on all regions. So Europe, EMEA, APEC and Americas. So it's very interesting to see what's happening within the system. Also, if you see the account names, you see that administrators used a lot. So this is information we will use at a later stage. Now going back to the hunting. But also an interesting feature is when you see an alert, you have to mitigate the alert. And if you see something happening, you can stop it at once, but it's better to get some insights. What is happening within our system? Is this patient zero, or where does it come from? Because if you stop something and they've built in a backdoor, they will come back and make it maybe even worse. So there's a live stream feature, and with the live stream feature, you can see real time what's happening within your system. So we'll let it start. Now I hope we will get some data. So this is currently happening within our system. Then you can see where the attacks are coming from. I see some weird names used, but this is really a nice feature. Maybe the not the best feature for the RDP attacks, but maybe for some other investigation. Let me pause it, else my system becomes very slow. So the proactive hunting, you can save the query with the bookmarks option, and you can do the live stream. Another thing is, and this is a little, it can be a little bit confusing because people are always saying Microsoft reduced the number of dashboards into one dashboard, and with workbooks you can create your own dashboards. But it gives you some valuable information. So if we look at the dashboard section and we use the same query, so we go to workbooks. And this is the part where it gets slow if you keep it running. And we go to the brute force attack. And here you can see I've used the username as entity on this dashboard. The the Linux machine is just up and running for a few days, but the Windows machine are up and running for much longer. And there you can see the word administrator, admin, administrator with a capital A, and lower cases are used most often. So with that information, it's an advice because Active Directory was created, I think, maybe 20 years ago, if it's not longer, and it uses the administrator name as the default name for the Breakout account. And I still see when I do a lot of security assessments that people are still using that name in the environment. So then you only have to guess the password. Now, if you deploy a machine in Sentinel, or sorry, in Azure, you cannot use the word administrator or admin because it's prohibited to use. You have to find another name. And there's also our advice to change the default administrator name to something else in your Active Directory environment to lower the chance that it is attacked via all port 3389 or if they are on another way entering your environment. Now, if you have an alert, you can use playbooks. And playbooks, you can, for example, block an IP address, block a user, Azure Active Directory user, send an email or post a Teams message or create a ticket in your ticketing system. So going back to the workbooks, the playbooks, here you can see I have a few playbooks, and what's nice to mention, in Azure Sentinel, you can use an Azure Sentinel alert or incident. So, for example, let me open this one. And here you can see it's a very simple one, but when I get a response from Azure Sentinel, when an alert is triggered, send an email. So if you go back to Sentinel itself and to the analytics rule, let me see if I can get my rule. Don't know which name I use, but that doesn't matter. Oh, I used another namespace, correct. Let me show it on this one. So if I have an alert rule, I can use edit, go to the automated response, and here I can select a playbook I want to use. So if an alert is triggered, send me an email, post it, a message in our SOC Teams channel, for example, or create a ticket. You can also use notebooks, and notebooks are, I'd say, only required if Azalog Analytics is not sufficient for the things you are doing. You can create a storyline, it's repeatable, shareable. You can use third-party graphical information. I haven't needed so far, and it's it can be quite complex, but it's an option to use within Sentinel itself. Now, like I said before, advice, don't use the administrator account. Use a different account, but with the same logic, we can also use the Honey Token feature in Azure ATP without Azure ATP. So if you create a user account, name it administrator, and look for the security event 4624, and then you can get an alert if the Honey Token account is compromised. So that's a way to protect your Active Directory privileged break glass accounts. Another thing, and that's basically about port 3389. You don't want port 3389 open to the internet. So the advice is to use, I will show you here, is the Microsoft feature in Azure Security Center, the standard tier, use JIT, just in time access. And with JIT, there's another deny rule is created above the RDP access rule. So port 3389 is just closed internal externally. But if you want to log on to the system, you go to the Azure portal, verify via credentials and MFA. You can switch it on and say, I want to access it from my source IP address or from a predefined IP addresses, maybe our admin range. And let me access it for 1, 2, 3 hours is the default. So then you have still the function of the RDP access, remote access, but it's more secure, more safe. So this is an option to mitigate the risk of RDP being compromised. And with that, are there any questions? There were no questions in between, so if maybe I talk too fast and they get not in between, or now is the time to answer some questions.
We didn't receive any questions yet.
Then it's all or very clear, or it's like I said, everything will be shared, the presentation, and yeah, my email address is in it. So if you got any questions, please let me know. Let me stop sharing. I didn't look at the time, that's good, but still, we have half an hour. Or everybody's hungry.
Oh, we'll wait for a while. We have a question coming up. We have a question for you, Derek, and it's related to why not using Azure Bastion for this?
Yeah, it's a very good question. We always would advise you Bastion, but Bastion at the moment is a little bit limited to the VNet. And if you have a complex infrastructure with a lot of VNets, it can be quite expensive, so to say. So I think when that part is solved, then Bastion will be the best solution because you don't have a public IP address connected to the internet. Still, you can also use it in combination with just-in-time access. Good question.
Okay. Well, let me. We always have a small lag of questions coming in, and when we see them, so we'll monitor that for a while. In the meantime, we again want to thank our sponsors. So let's keep this slide up and see whether some questions pop in. On the other hand, if people are seeing this presentations afterwards, maybe via YouTube, you have provided your email address. So that probably means that people can actually send you an email and you will respond to that as well. You can also contact us and we will make sure that any questions will be redirected to Derek. We have a new question coming up, which I will publish first. The question is, why should I use Sentinel for Windows security log analysis if I have access to ATA or Azure ATP?
Now, good question. ATA will be deprecated in the future, so our advice is always use Azure ATP. You don't have to struggle with your on-premises infrastructure, but Azure ATP basically looks at anomalies in the attack kill chain on your Active Directory. And with Sentinel, we can do much, much, much more. And we can also combine all alerts, all products together. So it's Azure ATP. We can combine with the, for example, your Cisco firewall, your AWS, everything is combined. You can do correlation on the different data sources. And then again, Azure ATP is only for Active Directory insights, like a past hash, reconnaissance. It's not triggering any alerts, for example, for for something that's not related to Active Directory.
Okay, thanks for that. Ah, another question coming up. So the questions are coming in, Derek. So one moment. The question is, does Sentinel work together with other on-premises SIEM solutions?
Yes, it does. I've seen a few that people want to see because before they do the switch, can it completely resolve it? But that's possible. Yeah.
Okay. And do they then have to import the data of that solution, or can you query that solution from Sentinel then?
Yeah, it depends. To be honest, there is a SIEM that's supported to do it working together, so to say, but you have two types of data sets. I'm not the expert in that. We haven't seen the question coming by, but it is possible if you have a another SIEM to just look at the Microsoft SIEM and have the data into two systems, so to say.
Okay, because I do have a question on my own. You said that you can either have a situation where actually you ingest all the data coming from the system, like an event log, and do your queries from there. On the other hand, you said, well, sometimes you actually you don't do that, for example, within Office 365, and then you actually only import the alerts being generated by that platform.
Yeah.
Can you tell us a little bit about what the advantages and disadvantages are of that?
Yeah. Yeah, very good question. And maybe also to answer the question before, maybe start with that. We have some really big customers, international, that have a big Microsoft infrastructure. For example, 80% is Microsoft, but 20% is non-Microsoft. And we as Inspark have, we are using the NIST cybersecurity framework that we have want to have a security baseline, which is the protect phase, and do the detect and response with the E5, with Azure Sentinel, etc. But if you want to connect non-Microsoft products, we as a Microsoft partner cannot say this is your security baseline. So then we are working with, we are part of KPN with a KPN SOC. It's the biggest SOC in the Netherlands. And then our Azure Sentinel SOC becomes a log source for the bigger SOC from KPN. Now, the thing is with, you can ingest alerts and incidents, you can ingest events, and you can ingest raw data. And for example, if you ingest raw data, we have a few data connectors, non-Microsoft, that gets a lot of data in it. And then the cost will be a few hundred, maybe a few thousand dollars a month only for that data connector. But yeah, the thing is, if you want to do some kind of correlation or investigations and you only have the alerts, you cannot see information past the alerts. You have to go back, for example, to Microsoft Defender ATP or to Microsoft Threat Protection to search in the raw data. It might become available in the future, but at the moment you can only search in the alerts, and you have to trust Microsoft that the alert is really the alert, and you cannot, it's hard to correlate extra data out of it.
But in the end, of course, it's all making sure that you're not storing too much data, because it will probably cost you money from that point forward.
The more data, the more it will cost you. You can use retention. So the longer you store it, the more it will cost you again. But yeah, you need to think about it. And for example, if you create your own use cases and don't use the Microsoft use cases, for example, in the E5 products, you are responsible of getting the alerts. And in the traditional SOC SIEM environments, you see, for example, that they have 10 use cases. And if somebody, a very smart hacker, creates an 11th one that will bypass the 10 and it's not feasible, then it's hard to explain the value of the SOC. And if you fall back to the Microsoft products, where the use cases are in the products on its own, for example, Azure ATP has 100 plus use cases in it, created by the Active Directory team, so a pass hash, a golden ticket, so you can trust Microsoft that it will find anomalies in the expertise areas that they are responsible of. So Active Directory, Azure Active Directory, the Microsoft endpoints, even though Linux, Mac, Android and iOS is also coming very soon to GA.
Yeah, sounds familiar. We used to know this in the SCOM world, where actually the product teams were also responsible for creating the management packs, and still are, of course.
Yeah.
But actually, the intelligence is provided by the product teams.
Correct.
Hey, yeah. We have three other questions coming up, so I hope you have some time left. Yeah. The first question is there a roadmap for Azure Sentinel available that you know of? So
yeah, yes, there is, but I cannot share.
Okay.
We participate in a lot of private previews, and it's all NDA information, even past before private previews. So we have the public previews, we have the GAs. The product is quite new, I think about a year or so, and it's really developing very fast. So there is a roadmap. I'm not aware of all functions that are happening, but if I talk to Microsoft, hey, this is a problem for us. Oh, we have a private preview for it. So there are a lot of private previews, but it's all NDA. But okay, a lot of nice things are coming in the near future, I can say.
Okay, but you're not aware of any web page actually displaying what's coming and etc.
I'm not aware of one single page where everything's in the a clear overview what's coming. No.
So if you want to know more about what's coming, I suggest that maybe to follow hashtag Sentinel, which will probably detail some things coming up. And if in the meantime we find this overview, we will of course share that with our audience. Hey, the second question is, if you already have a SIEM in an on-premise situation, would you separately use Sentinel specifically for Azure, or integrate the on-premise SIEM in Azure? And what are the advantages of using MS products only? So that are actually three questions in one. But
in one, yeah. I always said a year ago, you don't need a SIEM if you have a Microsoft-only infrastructure, because everything is managed within the product itself, like I mentioned before. That's why you have the E5 security products and the Azure Security Center, for example. And Microsoft is also doing more on correlation and integration, because all the E5 products are now combined to the Microsoft Threat Protection suite. That's also evolving. So in a Microsoft-only world, you don't really need Azure Sentinel, but you can use Sentinel to combine all incidents, dashboards, etc. into one interface. But you have most companies have non-Microsoft products, have on-premise products, so that's why where it brings true value. So if you have the traditional SIEM, my suggestion is we are starting currently with a few customers to start with Sentinel, basically with the E5. From there, at the Windows servers, for example, if your Windows servers are in Azure in a different workspace or on-premise, you can use a second MMA to send the data to Sentinel, and just slowly progressing and adding more data sources and more rules and fine-tune the rules, and from there look at the non-Microsoft. You can have them together and slowly migrate from your on-premise scene to the Microsoft cloud scene, so to say. That's my suggestion, not a big bang move or anything else. Yeah.
Okay. The next question popping up is that's actually an interesting one. What is the best way to start with Sentinel? I think you already answered it a little bit, but do you have anything to add for this question?
Yeah, start small is my suggestion. On the other hand, people say the first 30 days are free of charge. So if you connect everything at once, you can see, wow, this is the cost I will get in a few months. But it's too much, I think. It's not a fair, you can make it as complex as you want, but my suggestion is start slowly with the data, with the Microsoft data connectors. That's very simple because it's the data connector. And for the E5, it's just enabling one rule because the alerts are pushed from the product itself. And then look at the different features within. I hope this presentation makes it a little bit more clear that that you have the data connector, you have the analytics rules, you can do hunting, and you can use the dashboards to maybe help your SOC to get more insights.
The next question is actually from Michiel Wouters. And Michiel states, you mentioned only alerts from the Office 365 connector is stored in Azure Sentinel. Is it possible to store the underlying events of that Office 365 alert in Azure Sentinel for a longer retention, like 180 days? And he continues, same question for products like Identity Protection, which stores events for only 30 days. Can Azure Sentinel store these events for a longer time? So, good question, I think.
The short answer is yes. The longer answer, I was looking at what the data retention in Sentinel is, and it's 720 days. It's the maximum. And if you need even longer, there are also options for it. But it's a good question. We get the same question because some products store it 30 days, the other 90 days, and if you combine everything within Sentinel, you can use the retention from Sentinel for that. But still, it's only the alert data. It's not the raw data.
So, in the end, that you might want to store raw data because you might want to have a look back, and then not always alert data helps you. You need to have a look at the raw data because you might have a query for a question which wasn't asked at that time already.
Fully agree. There are some options, but that's too complex for this answer. So the retention is Sentinel. It's 720 days. And the first 90 days, for as far as I know, are free of charge. Then they will charge you. Yeah.
Okay. Next question is, are there any guidelines around cost? Not all is covered by the E5 license, correct?
Yeah, very good question. We're struggling with that also. That's why we have some real use cases that some data connectors are free. Like I said, some information is only alerts. Some information is events. That's a little bit more data. And some information or log data is raw data. And like I said, if you connect a Windows server, it's about €5 a month per server if you use the minimal. If you connect all Microsoft 365 products, like I said, we have 10,000 plus users. It's still around €5 a month. If you say, I want to connect a non-Microsoft product like a Cisco ASA, AWS, or a Zscaler, then it can evolve. And meten is weten, they say in the Netherlands.
On the other hand, especially customers, they want to know what they are will pay for. And that actually, that's perhaps something from the old world, because nowadays it's hard. Of course, you can make estimates, but you don't know the price exactly anymore.
Correct. And maybe you want to use some kind of filtering and you use parsing in your syslog server. So,
yeah.
That part is the more complex part if it's non-Microsoft.
Yeah, well, time will tell, but in the end, if you start filtering out data which you need later, yeah, you will probably be sorry as well. So, hey, that was actually the last question being asked. So, we have Dennis coming up. Yeah, Dennis, your question is not complete yet, so we will wait for a while and maybe see if you can rephrase your question so that we can ask it to Derek. In the meantime, let me switch slides. For the people attending, thanks for attending. We have a feedback URL. Please use it to provide your feedback. We want to do better every time. If you want to hear more from Derek, please also let us know. And maybe we can schedule Derek for maybe some other time. I think it was a very interesting topic, at least. Dennis, can you please rephrase your question, or else we have to end the meeting? Dennis, in that case, you can contact us or Derek, and he will be more than happy to reply to your question. So let's wait for a couple of...
Yeah, and thanks everybody for filling up my time with questions. So that will,
that also gives us the idea that there are a lot of questions on the product, so that's quite interesting. So that many people are actually interested in the product, which is good, I think. Dennis has no further questions. That means, Derek, that we are going to end this live event. Please stay for now. I will end the event, and for the other people, we are planning new events, and we will let you know soon. If you subscribe to our meetup page, you will automatically get emails with more details on that. Anything to add to that, Peter?
No. Wish everybody a nice holiday and enjoy the vacation if you have.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks all. Bye-bye.
Yep, bye-bye. Bye-bye.